as we worship our God. Thank you for coming. If you're visiting with us, welcome. We're going to start with our songs as we worship our holy God. Let's stand. Scripture says that there's only one mediator between us and the Father, and that is the man Jesus Christ, fully man, fully God. This is who we worship this morning. It's through him and only him that our sins are forgiven. And so as we get started with our songs, let's wrap our mind around who our God is. He's fully man and fully God. His name is Jesus Christ, and that's who we worship here this morning.
Thank you.
to our glorious Christ.
'Cause you are the glorious Christ, the greatest of all designs. Your power is unequaled, your love beyond all heights. No greater sacrifice than when you lay down your life. We join the song of angels who praise you day and night.
Empty tomb still speaks. Amen? Amen. Amen.
There is one gospel. one. We do not walk alone. We have His Spirit as we press on to lead us safely on.
A marvelous Savior, a wonderful Savior. Let's sing to Him.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how He could
shall ever be. How long?
We have a wonderful, marvelous Savior. Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, expectingly, Lord, speaking to us, your people, Lord, and drawing those who still don't know you, Lord, to a relationship with you. We thank you and we praise you, our God, for being the propitiation, the substitute for the wrath that we were supposed to expect. And yet our Savior Jesus Christ took it upon the cross. The empty tomb still speaks to this day. We're thankful for that truth. It's in Jesus' name we come. Amen.
Good morning. Well, I put my bulletin up here a little while ago, and I walked up here, and it wasn't here. I'm all, I need a bulletin. Well, welcome to Grace Chapel. We have a full house today. Praise God. Wonderful for that. So if you're visiting today, we'll just welcome you. Glad you're here. And in the seat in front of you, in the pocket, there's a welcome card, and if you can fill out the top of that, and you can turn it into a offering box in the back of the sanctuary, you can take it to the information desk in the foyer, and just have a record and see how you came to find Grace Chapel. So welcome. Glad you're here. All right, so today at 1:30, the Heart for the Lost is going to be going to La Quinta Park over by the high school. They're going to be doing an outreach. And one of the things they do is they set up a painting craft thing. And then that kind of draws parents and kids in. And they're able to share the gospel with the kids and the parents. So it's a beautiful day. If you want to join them, that's, again, at 1:30 p.m. today. So it's a great way to get introduced to sharing your faith and see, you can just observe and watch and pray and see how they do it. So, and on your bulletin on more happening at Grace, junior high and senior high updates, we want to say thank you to everybody for the golf tournament. I think we had a great time. The weather was like perfect, sunshine, cool breeze. It was great. Good food, the fellowship. We had people that weren't from our church come and play. I think we had a really great time. So we're overwhelmed with all of your generosity and participation so much. And then next week, too, the youth are going to be serving lunch. And I think we have a picture. Maybe they'll show it. But loaded tots. So there's going to be pulled pork on top of crispy tater tots, bunch of fixings, a homemade cookie, homemade macaroni salad. And so we'll be doing that outside after church. And so I hope you'll join us for that. Plan on just having lunch with church next Sunday. So that'll be fun. Also, retreats coming up for youth. As we know, we got the women's ministry Save the Dates. So ladies, Monday, April 29th and Saturday, May 11th. And you could read the details there. Then on happenings at Grace on the left side, VBS volunteer meeting today after the service. So if you are interested at all in helping with VBS, this would be the time to go. And you're going to just hear what the plan is. You can give your thoughts, and it'll be great. And so many hands are needed. And I know everyone just has an awesome time with the kids. It's just something about sharing God with little ones is like the best, right? It doesn't get any better than that. And we got the men's retreat. So men, make sure you're paid up. That's coming very, very close. And we have to be paid. We have to give a number of how many are going to be there. So please see John or just go pay at the kiosk at the information center. Women's Bible study starting April 11th, this coming Thursday at 9:30 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. So ladies, take note. Young adults will be meeting April 14th for our 1828 ministry. If you have any questions, you can call Pastor Kevin. His phone number is there. And we have Second Act Ministry will be meeting April 27th. 10 a.m. at the home of Leslie Flores' home. And then Wednesday night's ministries will be starting back up. We just took a week off, so youth group, Awana's, prayer, online ministry. So those are all back up. So as Pastor Kevin comes up, please stand up, greet one another, meet somebody new. I think there's a lot of new faces in here today. So, all right.
Three, two, one, Happy New Year! Well, welcome everyone. The 60-second countdown might have been new to you. And it seems like you're kind of oblivious to it anyways. Put it up there again, guys, just so they could kind of... Here's your new greeting timer. We rolled it back twice for you to this morning. Maybe we'll take it to 90 seconds for next Sunday. But yeah, so good to see the fellowship happening this morning. I'll tell you, next week we'll be able to fellowship over loaded tater tots. So yeah, that sounds good. I'm excited about that. So be prepared for that. This morning, though, we're going to feast on God's Word, and so we were going to pick up and continue in our study of Mark, Mark chapter 14. Just kind of give you a heads up of direction of where we're going. We'll be closing up Mark chapter 14 next Sunday, so I'll preach kind of the first half of this passage. Steve will close up the second half next week. And then on the 21st, we're going to have lots of our men. We have about 55 men signed up for the men's retreat. So several of them will be up at the retreat. And so that Sunday here, we won't continue in Mark. We'll actually take a break, and I'll pick up in a series that I started a while ago in Psalm 119. So we'll pick up, and we'll do a study in Psalm 119. And then we will introduce a mini-series, something that we don't normally do here, but we're going to have a little mini-series that we're tentatively titling Abiding in Truth. Abiding in Truth. And we're going to attempt to take some spicy cultural issues and present them to you in a biblical way. so that you, we would equip you, the saints of the church, of how do we think biblically about these things that the culture is attacking us with. So abiding in the truth, God's word versus the world's lies is kind of the idea of this mini series that we'll kick off at the end of April and will carry us through into early June. And then we'll pick back up in Mark later in June. So hope you guys are excited for that. Be preparing and praying for that. And we'll have some of those topics for you. So you might go, hey, I don't want to miss that Sunday. Hopefully you're like that every Sunday. But maybe there's going to be one year, I want to make sure that I'm there for that so I can write him an email and tell him how much I disagree with him. So hopefully that doesn't happen. So it's going to happen. This morning, I want to start off in a notation mentioning Bar Efrat, an author on Hebrew narrative specifically. He wrote a book called Narrative Art in the Bible. And in that work, he writes on many different facts of biblical narrative. One topic that he touches on is called dramatic irony. Dramatic irony develops when the reader knows more than the character in the story, or when the character does things and acts in a way that you as the reader know is not in their best interest. And so it becomes ironic. And dramatic irony is used to highlight a shocking event or to stress a tragic situation. A good example of dramatic irony is the movie The Truman Show. If you're familiar with that, in The Truman Show, Truman is the star of a popular TV show, but he doesn't know it. He thinks he's just living life. But you are drawn into the story, as well as those in the movie, the audience watching this is drawn into the story as he lives his real life amid a bunch of actors. And so you have information that Truman doesn't have. And so, again, it draws you in closer to the story. It gets you wanting to yell at the screen, no, Truman, go here. No, don't go there. Do this. Don't do that. That's the effect of dramatic irony. We see it in Scripture with King David, with what he's doing with Bathsheba. And we're like, no, King David, no. And then what he does with Uriah, we're like, King David, no. And then Uriah carrying his death warrant, we're like, Uriah, no. We see it also in the book of Esther, when the king wants to highlight somebody important. It's Mordecai, but Haman doesn't know that. And so the king goes to Haman and says, hey, what should we do to honor an individual? And Haman thinks, oh, this must be for me. And so he says of all these wonderful things, but it ends up being for Mordecai. This is dramatic irony. And in today's passage, we're going to see it as well, as the high priest condemns Jesus for the only true testimony at his trial. And the only true testimony at his trial, Jesus gets condemned. And so indeed, in this passage of Scripture we're looking at today, it's going to be full of dramatic irony. We, the reader of Mark's gospel, have been driving along in this story with Mark, and we've been drawn into it in looking and reading through all of Jesus' ministry up to this point. We've been given all the necessary details by Mark for us to come to the conclusion that Mark desires of us, right? He wants the readers to know who Jesus is, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And that's why he starts off his gospel in Mark 1:1 is the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He doesn't hide his purpose statement. And so hopefully, as we've gone through this study, that you've come to that conclusion yourself. And in your heart, you know that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, the one who created the heavens and the earth, the one who came in flesh, and the one who is coming again to judge the world and establish his kingdom. And we come to the climax of that story today. All of Mark's gospel is building up to this point and to this divine confession of Jesus. So we'll read from Mark chapter 14, verses 53 to 65. And if you are able to, please stand in honor to God's word as we read. Then they led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes gathered together. And Peter followed him at a distance right into the courtyard of the high priest. And he was sitting with the officers and warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were seeking to obtain testimony against Jesus to put him to death. And they were not finding any. For many were giving false testimony against him, but their testimony was not consistent. And some, standing up, were giving false testimony against him, saying, "We ourselves heard him say, 'I will destroy this sanctuary made without hands, and in 3 days I will build another made without hands.' And not even in this way was their testimony consistent. And the high priest stood up in their midst and questioned Jesus, saying, 'You answer nothing? What are these men testifying against you?' But he kept silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest was questioning him and said to him, 'Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?' And Jesus said, 'I am. And you shall see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.' And tearing his tunics, the high priest said, 'What further need do we have of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. How does it seem to you?' And they all condemned him to be deserving of death. And some began to spit at him and to blindfold him and to beat him with their fists and to say to him, 'Prophesy.' And the officers received him with slaps in the face." So ends the reading of God's word. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray that you would, Lord, do your work by your Spirit to prepare our hearts to receive your word. Lord, that you would soften hearts. Lord, those hard hearts today that are seeking excuses rather than seeking the truth. Lord, would you cause us to worship? Lord, would you raise up our affections and raise up our worship, Father, that you would be honored, that the name of Jesus Christ would be glorified, Lord, and our hearts would be satisfied in him. Father, do a work in us and amongst us, I pray in Christ's name. Amen. First two verses of this passage really set the scene. And so let's look at those introductory verses. And your notes, setting the scene. Setting the scene in verses 53 and 54. Verse 53, then they led Jesus away to the high priests and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes gathered together. And so what we see here in setting the scene is that we see Jesus before the Sanhedrin. Jesus was arrested in the garden. Now he's being led off to the home of Caiaphas, the high priest. In John's gospel, you would see there that Jesus is first taken to Annas, the former high priest. Then he's taken to Caiaphas, who is the current high priest and is the son-in-law to Annas. Likely this is the same complex. They didn't have to go to one high priest and then to the other, but they brought him to one complex, one courtyard, and one high priest would be on the other and his son-in-law would be across the way. And while John tells of the pre-trial, Mark doesn't go there. Mark just goes straight to the gathering of the Sanhedrin. And you see that there, that it's the chief priests, the elders, the scribes, the full Sanhedrin council were gathering. And it's just a vivid picture of what is going on. They're all gathering as Jesus waits there standing alone, bound in custody in the cold and dark of night. Jesus stands alone before many accusers. But he wasn't entirely alone, again, as we're setting this scene. We see that Peter was also before the servants. Peter was before the servants, verse 54. And Peter followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest. And he was sitting with the officers and warming himself at the fire. Peter follows at a distance, still afraid for his life, but unable to dismiss his feelings of loyalty to Jesus. Peter still follows, just not too close. He goes right into the courtyard of the high priest, it reads. In the original language, this suggests that it was unexpected. The way that the preposition stacked up here is it's unexpected that he ended up being this close, as though they stopped suddenly, or Peter wasn't expecting that where they would stop would be at the home of the high priest. Maybe he finally noticed all the elders and the scribes and the priests all gathering together, and so he stops now at the courtyard. It reads there that he stays with the officers. Literally, that is the servants or the helpers. It's the same ones that in verse 66, if you look at verse 66, it says they received him with slaps in the face. This is those same officers, same servants, the temple guards for the high priest, but the ones who Peter had just faced in the garden. He now finds himself with them in the lower courtyard. Indication that this is happening at night still is that we see that Peter warmed himself by the fire. Literally there, that is light. So by one of the torches or something that was there in the courtyard to give off light, Peter goes to and begins to warm himself next to it. So Peter is amongst the officers, the guards, doing Peter things, standing next to the light, showing his face while he's trying to remain hidden. This sets the scene. Jesus is in the upper area, either a second story of the building or another level of the complex, while Peter is in the lower courtyard. The narrative from here is going to move on, and it's going to refocus. Instead of introducing Jesus before the Sanhedrin and Peter before the servants, the focus is now going to come back on Christ and the trial. R.T. France calls this passage the Christological climax of the gospel. And he calls it a paradoxical presentation of Jesus. It's a paradox because at the narrative level, as we read the story, Jesus seems to be at the mercy of his captors. Yet at the theological level, we know he still reigns supreme. And while the force of this passage is found in the confession of Jesus to be the Christ, to be the Son of the Blessed One, the story is told in such a way that it vividly illustrates the errors of Jesus' enemies. And from this, we must learn. So in this passage, I want you to see three grave errors that culminate in the denial of the person and work of Jesus. Three grave errors that culminate in the denial of the person and the work of Jesus so that you would not be guilty of these errors. These grave errors, these deadly mistakes that the enemies of Jesus make in this passage are the same mistakes, the same errors, the same sins that result in people denying the deity and the salvific work of Christ today. And you need to be aware of these grave errors. And the first one is this: not seeking the truth. Not seeking the truth. Still today, as people deny Christ, they can be described as those who are not seeking the truth. They may say that they are, they may even think that they are, but in reality, they're not seeking the truth. They're not seeking God. In fact, Paul quotes the Psalms when he writes in Romans 3, 10 through 12, as it is written, there is none righteous, not even one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. There is none who does good. There is not even one. So we see this grave error of not seeking truth. And in this passage, that made me think of, okay, well, if it's apparent that they're not seeking truth, it made me want to start asking questions of this text. And so I'm going to look at three other questions of this section. And first of that is, what are they seeking? If they're not seeking the truth, what are they seeking? Verse 55-56. Now the chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were seeking to obtain testimony against Jesus to put him to death. And they were not finding any. For many were giving false testimony against him, but their testimony was not consistent. So we'll stop there. What are they seeking? They're searching for a charge. They're searching for testimony with which they could charge Jesus with a crime. Something else that they're seeking? I'll tell you, it's not a fair trial. They're not seeking a fair trial. There are discussion amongst the scholars as to whether this was even a legal trial or if it was a trial at all. And I'm not fully convinced on the idea that this was an illegal trial, but at least we could say that this is an unfair trial. This is an unfair trial. Why? Well, the regular meeting place for the Sanhedrin is not at Caiaphas's house. The regular meeting place would have been at the temple. They should have been meeting at the temple for a trial. But here, they're in Caiaphas's house, outside of the city walls. Capital trials such as this were to be held during the day. This is clearly at night, or at least it begins at night, and it may have finished early in the morning. Luke's chapter makes it read in such a way that it was the beginning of the day, maybe as the light started to come up. Evidence for innocence is to be presented first. Reasons why these charges or allegations would be untrue should be presented first, but they heard testimony against him first. Failure in agreement of witnesses should have resulted in the immediate release of Jesus. But we don't see that happening. Instead, Jesus is called to unlawfully testify against himself. So this is definitely unfair, but is it illegal for sure? It's difficult to say because the regulations that are recorded in the Mishnah for this are ratified in 200 AD. So it's some 170 years later. So these may have been best practices for them, but it's hard for us to say that these were hard laws that they would have served. Notice in verse 55 where the emphasis is placed. Now the chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were seeking to obtain testimony against him. Who's the one who's driving the car? Who's the leader of this three-ring circus? It's the chief priest. Why? That's my next question. Is what had they decided? What is it that they had decided? Verse 55b answers that. They're wanting to obtain testimony against Jesus. They're seeking testimony, not the truth. Why? Because they had decided to put him to death. They had already decided that he was guilty. The temple officials, the high priests, have been searching for a way to condemn him, going as far back as even Mark chapter 3, verse 6, where it says the Pharisees and the Herodians conspired to destroy him. Even as more recent, in Mark chapter 14, you're in 14, look at verses 1 and 2. Mark chapter 14, verses 1 and 2. Now the Passover and unleavened bread were 2 days away, and the chief priests and the scribes were seeking how, after seizing him in secret, they might kill him. For they were saying, not during the festival, lest there be a riot of the people. They're seeking how they might kill him. Look at verses 10 and 11. Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went away to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. Who did Judas conspire with? The chief priests. And when they heard this, they were glad and promised to give him money, and he began seeking how to betray him at an opportune time. So it was the chief priests who conspired with Judas. They had already made up their mind that Jesus was guilty. They were not seeking the truth. They were seeking evidence that would line up with their presuppositions, with their decision, with what they already decided to be true. They were just looking for evidence that would align with that. Now tell me that isn't relatable to the opponents of Jesus Christ and Christianity today. They are not seeking truth. But what they are seeking is evidence that aligns with what they already believe. People approach Christianity with a closed mind and argue against it and are not willing to look at truth. But there's been hundreds, thousands, maybe even millions of men who that thought process has backfired on. Two prominent examples in Christianity evangelicalism today is Lee Strobel and Josh McDowell. Maybe you've heard of those names, but both of those men sat out to research and to disprove Christianity, and instead were converted. As they looked for evidence and they examined evidence to show why Christianity was a myth or to show why it couldn't be trusted, as they looked at the evidence, these men were converted. They even ended up writing books, bestsellers, The Case for Christ, and Evidence That Demands a Verdict. So if you're here today looking for reasons to fight against Christianity, beware. You might be presented with evidence that might convert you. That's happened in the past. So that's how God works. But also even in that, if you are here today and you have a loved one who continues to kick against the truth, have hope. God converts people. God changes hearts. God brings truth and works it into the mind and to the heart of people and changes them. So for those stubborn loved ones, those stubborn family members, those stubborn friends, continue to have hope that God would save them. He's done it before. We see an example here of the chief priests, again, already deciding, right? So we're looking at the title. They weren't seeking truth. And so my next question is, what were they seeking? What had they decided? My next question is, why was all the testimony failing? Why is all the testimony failing? Verse 55, and we see that they were not finding any. They're not finding any testimony. Verse 56, for many were giving false testimony against him, but their testimony was not consistent. They're not finding any testimony worthy of putting him to death because it was inconsistent. The testimony was inconsistent. Many were giving testimony, it reads, but lies rarely align. Truth will align, but they couldn't find any clear testimony that all agreed with one another. It was inconsistent because it was untrue. Notice that it reads that many were giving false testimony. It doesn't read that they were seeking false testimony. And I think that's sometimes the way that we read this. In fact, Matthew's gospel is written in such a way that it alludes to that idea. But Mark doesn't go there. Mark doesn't write it in that way. And I think we should be careful that we don't jump to the conclusion that the leaders here were wanting people to lie. Why would these men stoop to that? Two reasons why I don't think we should go there is first is that the Old Testament, specifically the ninth commandment, prohibits false witness. And you might think, well, these guys don't have a problem breaking any other, but still, it's an evidence, so consider that. Secondly, they think he's actually guilty. So they're not looking for people to necessarily to lie. They're just looking for the evidence. You guys, tell us. You guys have all seen him out there. Tell us what he's been doing. We can get a charge against him. Clearly, they're so blinded, they're so deceived in that they want to see what they want to see. They're expecting to find it. But they're not. The testimony is inconsistent. Pause to think about that. They're so certain Jesus was worthy of death that they called many witnesses to prove it. Yet they couldn't produce any testimony. They couldn't produce any consistent testimony. And they never consider, well, maybe we're wrong. No, they keep pushing for a conviction rather than the truth, because they're not seeking the truth. Besides the testimony failing because it's inconsistent, it's also failing because it's a misrepresentation. It's a misrepresentation. Yes, it was a false testimony, and I'm not trying to water down the language here and call sin an oopsie. A sin is sin. It's not just a mistake. It's not just an oopsie. This is false testimony, but it is a misrepresentation. The fact that it's false testimony doesn't explicitly mean that it's a lie. But what they are testing to be true is false. You see the difference there? Somebody can believe and want to give testimony that this is true and be wrong. They may be convinced. We call them flat earthers. I'm convinced this is what I believe, but I'm sorry, they're giving false testimony. It's untrue, even though they believe it to be true. It's not necessarily that they're lying, because they believe it to be true. Do you see the difference? They're misrepresenting the truth, whether it's on purpose or by accident. Again, we're not sure, but it doesn't matter. It's still a false witness. Look at verse 57 and 59. And some standing up were giving false testimony against him, saying, verse 58, we ourselves heard him say. So here, we're going to go on record now. And I quote, here's what Jesus said, verse 58. I will destroy this sanctuary made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another made without hands. Where are they getting this? Where do the witnesses get this idea? In fact, you may even hear that and you're like, yeah, I remember Jesus saying something similar to that. Where? Not in the Gospel of Mark, not in the Gospel of Matthew, not in the Gospel of Luke. You know where you hear Jesus say something like that? Is in the beginning of John's Gospel, in John chapter 2. So turn there. In Mark and Matthew, the only time that you hear this idea of destroying the temple in 3 days is in this testimony account. John chapter 2, beginning in verse 13, you'd see that Jesus is clearing the temple. On a Passover time, again, he found the temple's full of selling, full of a business, and he drives them all out. Verse 16, he says, take these things away. Stop making my Father's house a place of business. And in verse 18, it says, and the Jews said to him, what sign do you show us as your authority for doing these things? Now pause. You might think, wait a minute, didn't this happen at the beginning of Passion Week? Something very similar to this happened at the beginning of the Passion Week. John moves it all the way forward. And so we don't see any reason to believe that this didn't happen at two different times. At the beginning of his ministry, that Jesus goes in and clears the temple and drives these people out and they question him. And then again, upon his re-entry during Passion Week, he does it again. And now these people in where we are in Mark are looking back to 3 years earlier, trying to quote something that Jesus may have said then. Jesus is answering their question of authority and answering their question of this. In verse 19, Jesus answered them, "Destroy this sanctuary, and in 3 days I will raise it up." And the Jews said to him, "It took 46 years to build this sanctuary, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" What does verse 21 read? But he was speaking about the sanctuary of his body. So when he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had spoken. Now going back to Mark chapter 14, how does this align with what we see in Mark 14? Well, in verse 58, we see, "I will destroy this sanctuary." Well, Jesus didn't say, "I will destroy this sanctuary." He says, "You destroy this sanctuary, and in 3 days, I will raise it up." That's what he said in John. But verse 58 is emphatic. He says, "I myself will build another made without hands." The testimony against Jesus is getting parts of what he said correct, but it's mixing in with something else. Where would they have got this idea of him destroying the temple? He said, "You destroy the temple and I will raise it." Speaking of his body, which happens in the resurrection. Where did they get the idea of destruction? Well, turn to Mark 13. Mark 13, verse 1. "And as he's going out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, 'Teacher, behold, what wonderful stones and what wonderful buildings.'" Do you remember when we went through this several months ago and we talked about the beauty of the temple and how they would have been going out of, I think it's the east gate at this point, and would be walking down the road, and as they do this, the beautiful buildings that would have been there gleaming in the sunlight, the golden hour. Look at how beautiful this is. So they're walking. This is in a public place. And Jesus said to him, "Do you see all these great buildings? Not one stone will be left upon another which will not be torn down." Whoa. Jesus just said that the temple was going to be destroyed. It's interesting. There's two different words here. Here it's temple. The idea is the temple meaning the kind of the whole temple mount, the whole area, as opposed to the sanctuary, which John uses, and then in the testimony against Jesus is used, meaning the really kind of the inner temple, like the actual proper temple building. And so there's a conflation of these two stories. People are taking some of the things that he said over here and some of the things that they said over here, and it's kind of bringing them together and joining them and making something else out of it. This is like Twitter before Twitter. You know, we're just gonna misquote you and take a little sound bite and use it to mean what we want it to mean. And so again, this is why, and look at verse 59 of Mark 14 again. Why, not even in this way, was their testimony consistent? Because nothing that they were presenting was true. Nothing that they were presenting was true. It's all a misrepresentation. They couldn't bring any true charges against Jesus because he is the sinless Son of God. He is the spotless Passover lamb on his way to the cross to be crucified. And so to try to come up with dirt on him is difficult because you just can't find it. Before we move into the next verses and see the response of the high priest, we need to understand something about the testimony regarding the destruction of the temple. And so I want us to turn to the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 26. Jeremiah will be right after Isaiah, before Lamentations and Ezekiel. Jeremiah 26. Just kind of set you up for what we're going to see in this. There's two examples of men here who prophesied that the temple would be destroyed. You're going to see Jeremiah and Uriah. Now, when you see Uriah, don't think David and Bathsheba. Right? This is separated by some 400 years. This is a different Uriah. But look in verse. Verses 1 through 6 basically summarize there. Yahweh comes to Jeremiah and he says, go and pronounce this judgment that the temple will be destroyed. Verse 6, it says, I will make this house like Shiloh. This house of God, the house of Yahweh will be destroyed. And this city I will make a curse to all the nations of the earth. There's the judgment that Jeremiah proclaims. Now verse 7, the priests and the prophets and all the people heard Jeremiah speaking these words in the house of Yahweh. Now it happened that when Jeremiah finished speaking all that Yahweh had commanded him to speak to all the people, the priests and the prophets and the people seized him, saying, you must surely die. Why have you prophesied in the name of Yahweh, saying, this house will be like Shiloh, and this city will be laid waste without inhabitant? And all the people gathered about Jeremiah in the house of Yahweh. And when the officials of Judah heard these things, they came up from the king's house of the house of Yahweh and sat in the entrance of the new gate of the house of Yahweh. Where is this, trial taking place? Somebody's house in the middle of the night? No, it's not. It's there in the temple. Verse 11, and then the priests and the prophets spoke to the officials and to all the people, saying, a judgment of death for this man, for he has prophesied against the city as you have heard in your hearing. Verse 12, then Jeremiah spoke to all the officials and to all the people, saying, Yahweh sent me to prophesy against this house and against this city all the words which you have heard. So now make good your ways and your deeds, and listen to the voice of Yahweh your God, and Yahweh will relent of the evil demise which he has spoken against you. It says, there's time for you. Repent of these evil deeds, and God will relent. Verse 14, but as for me, behold, I am in your hands. Do with me as is good and right in your eyes. Only know for certain that if you put me to death, you will bring innocent blood on yourselves and on this city, and on its inhabitants, for truly Yahweh has sent me to speak to you all these words in your hearing. The officials and the people said to the priests and the prophets, no judgment of death for this man, for he has spoken to us in the name of Yahweh our God. And some of the elders of the land rose up and spoke to the assembly of the people, saying, Micah of Moresheth prophesied in the days of Hezekiah, king of Judah, and he spoke to all the people of Judah, saying that thus Yahweh of hosts had said, Zion will be plowed as a field, and Jerusalem will become a heap of ruins, and the mountain of the house will become the high places. Did Hezekiah, king of Judah, and all of Judah put him to death? Did he not fear Yahweh and entreat the favor of Yahweh? And Yahweh relented of the evil demise which he had spoken against them. But we are committing a great evil against ourselves. You understand what just happened there? Jeremiah comes and he pronounces this judgment and they're ready to kill him. And Jeremiah says, hey, okay, if you want to do that, but there's going to be greater judgment on you. Now, one of these other priests and stands up and he says, hey, do you remember there were other prophets who came before and said, woe to you, that you need to repent? Did we kill those men? No, we didn't kill those men. What did we need to do? We needed to repent. But it doesn't always go that way. Look at Uriah in verse 20. Indeed, there was also a man who prophesied in the name of Yahweh, Uriah the son of Shemaiah from Kiriath-Jearim, and he prophesied against this city and against this land words similar to all those of Jeremiah. And King Jehoiakim and all his mighty men and all the officials heard his words, so the king sought to put him to death. But Uriah heard it, and he was afraid and fled and went to Egypt. Then King Jehoiakim sent men to Egypt. Elnathan, the son of Achbor, and certain men with him went into Egypt, And they brought Uriah out of Egypt and led him to King Jehoiakim, who struck him down with the sword and cast his dead body in the burial place of the common people. There was a great judgment on these people and a great hatred towards those who would speak against the temple of the Lord. You have to understand that, right? We can't just put our own modern day twist onto this story. We need to go back and we need to understand this from the perspective of these people, of these high priests, of these people who Jesus is talking to. As they're hearing these stories that he said that this temple is going to be destroyed, they're outraged. This is the response. The Jewish people did not accept people speaking against the destruction of the temple. They treated it as a capital offense worthy of death. And so this prompts the response that we see from the high priest in verses 60 and 61. But also in verses 60 and 61, we're going to see the second grave error. And the second grave error is that he's not recognizing the truth. Not recognizing the truth. So the first grave error is not seeking the truth. The second grave error is not recognizing the truth. The high priest hears all this testimony and it's lining up for these charges against him. And so now he intervenes. Now he intervenes about these charges against the temple destruction. Verse 60, Mark 14. And the high priest stood up in their midst and questioned Jesus, saying, "You answer nothing? What are these men testifying against you?" I'll just stop there at verse 60. The high priest is not recognizing the truth. He is recognizing the false testimony, though. So my next point for you is that he did recognize the false testimony given. We see in verse 55 and 56 and even in 55 that there's a recognition that the testimony that's being given is false because it couldn't be corroborated. Right? The testimony of two or three witnesses is necessary, especially in the case of death. You can look at Deuteronomy 17:6, Numbers 35:30. Deuteronomy 17:6, Numbers 35:30 both state that a man, in order to be found guilty and worthy of death, must have the testimony of two or three witnesses. But even any charge, Deuteronomy 19:15 simplifies it on the screen for you. I like how the ESV words this. A single witness shall not suffice against a person for any crime or for any wrong in connection with any offense that he has committed. Only on the evidence of two witnesses or of three witnesses shall a charge be established. You can't convict a person of a crime on the testimony of a single witness. And the high priest is recognizing this, and the high priest is recognizing the false testimony that's being given while still not recognizing the truth in front of him. What's the truth that's in front of him? Look at 61. But he, Jesus, kept silent and did not answer. And again, the high priest was questioning him and said to him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?" This charge of temple destruction, this high priest makes an unusual move, and he goes from being the judge to being the prosecutor. Before everyone in the council, it says that he stood above them, and he goes to Jesus and he says, "You answer nothing." In the Greek language, it's emphatic. There's this interesting double negative. It's like, not you are answering nothing. It's like, you got to respond to these charges. This is serious stuff that's being brought up against you, and you answer nothing. You're not going to defend yourself. Don't you know about Jeremiah? Don't you know about Uriah? Uriah was killed for this. Jeremiah made a defense and was spared. But he kept silent. imperfect in the original language, meaning he was continuously being silent. He remained silent, the same silence from which he looked on this entire trial as he stood alone, bound in the cold of night. He remained silent. He answered nothing. This should have been different for the high priest. This should have set off some warning bells. This should have seemed strange to him. But sin blinded him. His hatred and his desire to find damnable testimony blinds him. He's so blind that he does not even realize that he is being a part of the fulfillment of Scripture. So he did not recognize the fulfillment of prophecy which he was participating in at that moment. He completely misses it. His actions with Jesus in this moment, some commentators will point to Psalm 38:13-14 as fulfillment of Jesus' silence here. But Isaiah 53, certainly, speaking of the suffering servant, covers it. Isaiah 53:7, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter and like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth. In the description of the suffering servant who would bear the iniquities of many, who would carry away their transgressions, in that same description is this that says that he remains silent. And Jesus does not open his mouth because he has no reason to. None of the charges were validated by witnesses. There's no legal testimony against him. And frustration grows with the high priest to the point that he just tells him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?" Matthew 26:63, Caiaphas says, he puts him under oath. He says, I charge you under the oath of God. I demand an answer out of you. Answer this question. Are you the Christ? Are you the Son of the Blessed One? Again, in his piousness, he wouldn't say God. He wouldn't say Elohim. He wouldn't even say Adonai. He certainly wouldn't say Yahweh because he didn't want to be accused of blasphemy. He wouldn't want to be accused of using the Lord's name in vain. And so he says, Blessed One, are you the Son of the Blessed One? Tell us, is this true? But remember, as he asks this, the disposition of his heart, as we've already seen, the disposition of his heart and of this inquiry isn't genuine, right? We've seen the grave errors that culminate in the denial of Jesus. He's not seeking the truth. He's not recognizing the truth. And now we'll see the third error. He's not receiving the truth. He's not receiving the truth. The climax of Mark's gospel is upon us. The hinge point in the ministry of Jesus was back in chapter 8. But now we come to the climax. The hinge was Peter confessing Jesus as the Christ and Jesus silenced him, saying, tell no one about this. And the messianic secret continues. Now, at the Christological climax, the confession of Jesus, we see Jesus on trial and called to testify as to who he is. And he doesn't back down. He knows that his testimony will condemn him in their eyes. He knows the consequences of what he will say. But he answers truthfully because God cannot lie. And so he says and makes the divine confession that we read in verse 62. And Jesus said, I am. I am. This simple statement, we see the truth and the implication from Jesus. The truth is his simple affirmation to this question. Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One? He simply responds, I am. The words of the Father when he revealed himself to Moses in Exodus 3:14. I am who I am. I am has sent you. The confession would have, that confession would have been enough just to say that I am, but he doesn't stop there. He talks about the implication of that truth. Because I am, you shall see something. You shall see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven. A reference to Psalm 110, where it says, Yahweh says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put my enemies as a footstool under your feet. And Jesus says, you will see me sitting at the right hand of power. I'll play the same name game. You can't get me in a charge of blasphemy. I won't say at the right hand of the Father, at the right hand of God. I'll say at the right hand of power, so you can't charge me with blasphemy. And then he says, you'll see me coming with the clouds of heaven, and I will be returning with judgment, is what that means. I'm going to come, and I'm going to set up a kingdom, and I will be a judge. You think that you are in power now. You think that you're a judge. I'm returning as judge. High priest says amen and bows and worships him. No. Verse 63, and tearing his tunics, the high priest said, what further need do we have of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. How could they charge this as blasphemy? Because claiming to be equal with God was a defamation of the name of God. In their eyes, he defamed the name of God. He disrespected who God was by claiming to be his equal. Leviticus 24:16. Moreover, the one who blasphemes the name of Yahweh shall surely be put to death. All the congregation shall surely stone him, the sojourner as well as the native. When he blasphemes the name, shall be put to death. Now there's some who will tell you, they'll come to your door and they'll knock, and they'll tell you that Jesus never claimed to be God. You must understand this verse so that you can explain that. You must understand that from this is a clear indication that Jesus claimed to be God. James Edward wrote this as, this is a powerful indirect proof of Jesus' claim to be the Son of God. Caiaphas, the high priest, understood this claim of equality, tears his tunics, calls it out for blasphemy. He speeds up the process. They reject him and charge him with blasphemy. And the final point, the condemnation and mistreatment from them all. All the religious, pious men who claim to be serving God spit on Jesus. They blindfold him. They beat him. They mock him, saying, prophesy. Hey, who hit you? When the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes had rejected Jesus just as he said would happen, just as scripture said was necessary, he gets turned over to the temple guards, to the officers, and they receive him with slaps in the face. Read that again in verse 64. You have heard the blasphemy. How does it seem to you? And they all condemned him to death, deserving of death. And they began to spit at him and to blindfold him and to beat him with their fists and to say to him, prophesy. And the officers received him with slaps in the face. Do you see the glory in Christ's confession to be the Christ, the Son of God? Do you see that confession as glorious? Do you see the dramatic irony in this story? That the only truth that was told that night is what they twist to condemn him. You see Jesus being mistreated and want to scream out, no, no, he's innocent. Then the Gospel of Mark did its purpose in your life. The Spirit of God has done its purpose in your life. Think of this, though. Despite how he's mistreated, Jesus would come to pray for these men who did this to him. as he hangs on the cross, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. Yet many won't come to church because they think they're undeserving of forgiveness. Many will come to church and sit here and never turn to Christ for forgiveness because they think they are undeserving. These men were forgiven by Christ. Forgiveness was offered to them, at least. Band can come up at this point. At the start of this study, I said that in this passage, I wanted you to see three grave errors. I wanted you to see three grave errors that culminate in the denial of the person and work of Jesus Christ so that you wouldn't be guilty of any of these errors. So I ask you, did any of them stick out to you? Are you guilty of not seeking truth? Of not recognizing truth? Of not receiving the truth? Paul writes of receiving, Paul the Apostle writes of receiving the truth as being, of accepting of it as true, as believing. If you haven't received that truth today, you can. If God has softened your heart to hear this message and understand, and you see these claims that Jesus has made, and you accept now that he is the Christ, the one who brought salvation to his people. If as we've studied Mark, you've been confronted with his perfect life, his atoning sacrificial death, as we celebrated last week, his victorious resurrection, you can receive that truth today. You repent of your sins. You turn to Christ for forgiveness. You turn to him as your Savior and as your Lord. You believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead and you will be saved. If you have any doubts to that, talk to the person who invited you today. If you have any doubts to that, you can come to the front afterwards and pray with me or one of the other elders. But for the rest of us who know Christ, let's worship him. This one who came, endured this mocking, even though he was the Son of God. Worthy of all praise, he was spat on. Worthy of devotion, he was beat with fists. Let's praise him in song. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. Lord, aware of our sin and our unworthiness, Lord, we can see ourselves in this passage as being those who at one time were not seeking truth. We're not recognizing truth and we're not receiving the truth. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the love which he loved us, caused us to be united with Christ. Lord, would you do that work in more hearts this morning? And would you cause those who know you to have their affections stirred that we might live in more Christ-like obedience to our Heavenly Father? Not for legalistic reasons, not to show we're better than the world, but just out of love and in response to what's been done for us. We praise you and we thank you in Christ's holy name. Amen.
Screw.
Paul, in his letter to the Thessalonians, gives thanks to God because of how they received the word. Listen to this. This is 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13. And for this reason, we also thank God without ceasing that when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as the word of men, but for what it really is, the word of God, which also is at work in you who believe. Prayer for you this week is that you would remember and receive the word of God, and it would be working in you who believe. Amen. You are dismissed.